Hallelujah. 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 Let us go. This is the Lord's day. Yahweh's day. Yah day. As we call it, Yah day. This is January the 15th, 1927 service. This is Yah day, the day of the Lord. The scripture that the Holy Spirit gave us today, the scripture that he gave us today to build us up, to instruct us, is Luke 1, verses 36 to 38. Anyone to read? Anyone to come over here to read the scripture? Luke 1, verses 36 to 38. Hallelujah.
And behold thy cousin, Elizabeth, she have also convinced a son in her old age. And this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For with God nothing shall be impossible. And Mary said, behold the handmaid of the Lord. Be it unto me according to thy word. And thy angel depart from her.
Hallelujah. Praise be to our holy God. Hallelujah. Praise be to Yahweh. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Today, the Lord teaches us about the notion that nothing is impossible, as you just heard the scripture of the day say. Nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible. In writing his book to the primary recipient, who he refers to as the most excellent Theophilus, as we see it in Luke 1 verse 3, and also Acts 1 verse 1, because also Luke is the one who wrote the book of Acts. And he's addressing the book to someone. Someone he refers to as most excellent Theophilus, a title that suggests someone of wealth or authority, someone of reputation. You remember our last sermon last week, the Lord talked to us about reputation. So the person to whom Evangelist Luke addresses his books, This book of Luke is Theophilus. So Evangelist Luke's intent was to explain the story of Yahshua to the Gentiles and also to make the Gentiles know about Yahweh. The clues that lead us to that belief are at least two. He tended to give details about Jewish locations. He makes a great effort to describe Jewish location, which would have been obvious to the Jews. So if his audience were the Jews, he wouldn't be going to all these details for things that are obvious to the Jews. Also, Theophilus is most likely a ranking official, and the way he explained things to Theophilus are the way you would explain only to pagan, to people who don't know Yahweh. So Theophilus, it was most likely a Gentile, not a Jew. Now let us explain. Because in the Bible, there is this word Gentiles that comes over and over again. Let us define what Gentiles means. In Hebrew, this is a word that is always in plural. And the word that is refers to the same notion is goyim in plural, which means in general all nations except the Jews. So in the course of time, as the Jews began began more and more to pride themselves on their particular privileges. Gentiles, the word Gentiles, acquired unpleasant associations and was used as a term of contempt. In the New Testament, the Greek word is Hellenes, which means literally Greek, as we see it in Acts 16, verse 1, verse 3, Acts 18, verse 17, Romans 1, verse 14. And that term in the New Testament generally denotes any non-Jew nation, non-Jewish nation. Gentiles came to designate all the people who were not Jews and who were so called by them, the Jews. They were called that way by the Jews, being aliens, most because they were aliens from the worship, the rights, and the privileges of Israel. The word was used contemptuously by them. In the New Testament, as I said, because there is a difference to make between the Old Testament and New Testament. In the New Testament, the word is used as equivalent to Greek, as I say. But this use of the word seems to have arisen from the almost universal adaptation of the Greek languages. The Gentiles were far less sharply differentiated from the Israelites in the Old Testament than in the New Testament times. Under Old Testament regulations, the Gentiles were simply non-Israelites. When we say non-Israelites, it's not from the stock of Abraham by blood. But they were not hated and despised for that reason, except certain tribes in Canaan, to whom there were special regulations. There were special regulations of non-intercourse in the scripture, in the Torah. The Gentile stranger enjoyed the hospitality of the Israelite, who was commanded to love him, and this is in Deuteronomy 10, verse 9. The Israelite was commanded to sympathize with the Gentiles. I quote the scripture, I read the scripture. "For ye know the heart of the stranger, seeing you were strangers in the land of Egypt." End of quote. This is a quoting Exodus 23, verse 9. But as we approach the Christian era, the attitude of the Jews toward the Gentiles changes, until we find in the New Testament times the most extreme aversion, scorn, and even hatred toward the Gentiles. Gentiles were then regarded as unclean, with whom it was unlawful to have any friendly intercourse. They were the enemies of God and his people. They were viewed as the enemies of God and his people, to whom the knowledge of God was even denied by the Jews. All this by the Jews. Unless they became proselytes. And even then, even if they became proselytes, they could not. As in ancient times, to be admitted to full fellowship, Jews were forbidden to counsel them. And if they asked about divine things, they were to be cursed. All children born of mixed marriages were called bastard. Marriages between Jews and Gentiles, they were called bastard. This caused the Jews to be hated by the Greeks and the Romans, whom they called the Gentiles. For we have abundant evidence in the writings of Greek and Roman authors like Cicero, Seneca, or Tacitus. Something of this is even reflected in the New Testament. I quote this scripture. Then led they Yahshua from Caiaphas unto the hall of judgment, and it was early. And they themselves went not into the judgment hall, lest they should be defiled, but that they might eat the Passover. End of quote. This is John 18, verse 28. But this can also be found, the same parent can be found on Acts 10, verse 28, Acts 11, verse 3. So as you see, the judgment hall was the hall of judgment of the Romans, and the Romans are the Gentiles, and they didn't want to go there because they felt they will be defiled by standing on the hall of judgment. So if we inquire what the reason of this change was, we may find it most probably in the conditions of the exiled Jews in Babylon, who suffered the bitterest treatment at the hands of their Gentile captors, the Babylonians. And then, after their return and establishment in Judea, they were in constant conflict with neighboring tribes, and especially with the Greek rulers who were ruling from Syria. The fierce persecution of the Greek emperor Antiochus IV, who attempted to blot out their religion and to Hellenize is making things become Greek, imposing, turning everything to Greek, to turning everything, imposing Greek culture, because Greek culture is Hellenes in Greek language. So that emperor tried to Hellenize the Jews. And also the Jews were always in desperate struggle for independence. All these things created in them a burning patriotism and a zeal for their faith in Yahweh, which culminated in a rigid exclusiveness that we see in later time, in particular in the time of Yahshua and the apostles. So the Gentiles are the pagans, the heathen, the idolaters, the atheists, all aliens to the belief in Yahweh are called the Gentiles. So this is how Luke explains the divine announcement of Mary. Now to go back in the scripture of the day, let us start with how Luke explained the announcement of Mary's immaculate pregnancy. Immaculate means without stain, without sin in the pregnancy. I quote verses 28 to 31 of Luke 1. It says, "And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Yah-shua. End of quote. This is Luke 1 verses 28 to 31. So the angel gave her the name Yah-shua, which in Hebrew, Yah is the short for Yahweh. Shua means salvation. So the word Yah-shua means Yah's salvation, Yahweh's salvation. Yahweh's salvation, or what we call commonly the Savior. What when we say all the time, referring to Yah-shua, when we say the Savior, we are just saying his name, Yah-shua, which is, the name means the incarnation of Yahweh's salvation on earth. And also, the name Yah-shua is the fulfillment of the prophecy of prophet Isaiah, who said his name will be Emmanuel, which means God with us. God with us. Isaiah didn't mean that the name should be exactly Emmanuel, but he said who he should be, God with us. And with Yah-shua, we see the incarnation of the salvation of Yahweh, which is the fulfillment of the prophecy, Emmanuel. So let us go to scripture interpretation. Verse 36, it says, and behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, end of quote. The case of Elizabeth is mentioned by the angel to inspire Mary with confidence and to assure her that what was now promised to her would be fulfilled. It was almost as improbable that Elizabeth should have a child at her time of life, old, because Mary, as it was that Mary should, under the circumstances that were promised to her, immaculate conception. Announcing to her the conception of an old woman who was known as a barren woman. That was to reassure her. Then so the scripture says, I quote, it says, she had also conceived a son in her old age, end of quote. Though Mary asked no sign, and this is important, this goes to the heart of the message of that the Holy Spirit is giving us today. Though Mary asked no sign, yet one is given her, whereby she might know the truth of what was spoken by the angel. For if it appeared that Elizabeth had conceived, that she had received the strength to conceive, as was declared by this angel, and that a son too, which she could not have known without a divine revelation, and that in her old age, which was extraordinary and supernatural, she might So Mary might assure herself that the message brought to her was from God Himself. And that Mary, likewise, for a virgin, might conceive and bear a son. This is like a way for God, for Yahweh, to force this young girl to have faith by reassuring her that she, at the same time I'm telling you that you're going to conceive while you are a virgin, this is what was revealed to your cousin, an old woman, Elizabeth. She will have a son, even at her old age. So, the angel adds all this as a further testimony of the truth of things. Then the scripture says, I quote, I read, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren, end of quote. In the sixth month from her conception, by which time women used to be at some certainty about their quickening, so that Mary could go and check it with her and have the confirmation from herself that, yes, I am pregnant. So the angel says something like this. You must not therefore think this impossible. For you know Elizabeth was counted barren and was old, yet she has conceived. So it was a plain case and out of question. The signs of her pregnancy were very apparent. So verse 37, it says, I quote, I read, for with God, nothing shall be impossible, end of quote. This is consistent with Yahweh's nature and perfections, with His counsels, purposes, and promises. Everything that He has said, purposed, or promised, Yahweh is able to do and will do. Every word that He has spoken, everything predicted by His prophets or declared by His angels, like in this case, and particularly, as I said, at that of a virgin's conceiving and bearing a son, so that the angel not only answers her question, because she asked, how deep should be? She asked. So the angel asked her, answers her question here by saying it, that with Yahweh, that nothing is impossible. So the angel confirms confirms her that it will be done. And this also confirms Mary's faith in it. Partly by the instance of her cousin Elizabeth, and partly by observing the infinite omnipotence of Yahweh. Verse 38, it says, and Mary said, behold, the handmaid of Yahweh, end of quote. This was an expression of resignation to the will of God and of faith of the promise, in the promise of God. To be the handmaid of Yahweh is to be submissive and obedient. And it's the same thing as saying, I read, it is like saying, I fully credit all that is said, and I'm perfectly ready to obey all the commands of you, of Yahweh. in which words she expressed her obedience or faith. She owns herself to be the handmaid, which means the servant of Yahweh. And she desires to obey him and be submissive to him as such. And tacitly, she acknowledges her meanness and her great unworthiness. Then the scripture says, Mary still speaking, I quote, "Be it unto me according to thy word," end of quote. She assented to what the angel said should be unto her. She earnestly desired it might be, and she firmly believed it would be. She said her amen to the angel's message. Then the scripture says, I quote, "And the angel departed from her." Not until then, we can add. He departed to the heavenly regions from whence he came, to his great Lord, Yahweh, and Master, who sent him. Having dispatched the business he came about, and which he was accountable to Yahweh for. The angel did not leave until he saw Mary's expression of faith. Remember that the same angel appeared to Zacharias, Elizabeth's husband, many months before, to announce him the birth of John the Baptist. But because Zacharias, remember the story, because Zacharias, it is anywhere you can read Luke 1, starting with verse 1, to check what I'm saying here. So because Zacharias doubted that at her old age, that his old barren wife would ever give birth. So because of that unbelief, because of that doubt, the angel made Zacharias mute until the birth of John the Baptist. He never spoke again. So the angel waited. The angel waited here. He waited to set Mary's faith. He waited to see Mary's faith before he departed. We may think of Yahweh behaving like a man about to make a gift, that Zechariah's doubt would make the Lord change his mind. If Yahweh was a man, that is what we would think, that he could just change his mind and go and put that baby in the womb of another woman. Or that by waiting to see Mary's faith first before he departed, this would maybe suggest that Yahweh would have changed his mind otherwise. That means if Mary had not shown faith, maybe Yahweh would have changed his mind and put the baby Yah-shua in the womb of another woman. But Yahweh is not like that. Yahweh is not like that. Yahweh's grace is final and most of all irreversible. Yahweh's grace is irreversible. Let us then talk about irreversible grace. The doctrine of irreversible grace refers to the biblical truth, because all this is in scripture. The biblical truth, the scriptural truth, that whatever Yahweh decrees to happen will inevitably come to pass. John the Baptist was to get born from the specific barren old woman called Elizabeth. And Yahshua had to get born from a specific virgin girl called Mary. That's it. It would not have happened otherwise. That is what is called irreversible grace. When God has given a grace, that grace is irreversible. He cannot change. God is not like man who changes his mind all the time. This applies even to the salvation of individuals, and that is what we're going to talk about because this concerns us. Irreversible grace of salvation. The Holy Spirit will work in the life of the elect. Elect is the chosen one of Yahweh, so that they would inevitably come to faith in Christ. No way that they can run away from it. Scripture teaches us that the Holy Spirit never fails to bring to salvation those sinners whom he personally calls to Christ. Remember, the Holy Spirit is Yahweh. This is the Spirit of Yahweh. I say again, the Holy Spirit never fails to bring to salvation those sinners whom he personally calls to Yahshua Christ. I read the scripture that confirms it. I read. All that, this is Yahshua speaking, I quote, all that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. For I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. And this is the Father's will, which had sent me, that of all which he had given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up in the last day. End of quote. This is a quote from John 6, verses 37 to 40. At the heart of the doctrine of irreversible grace is the answer to this question. The question is, why does one person believe the gospel and another does not? Why do some people become Christians and others not? Is it because one is smarter, has better reasoning capabilities, or possesses some other characteristics that allows him to realize the importance of the gospel message? Or is it because Yahweh does something unique in the lives of those whom he saves? If it is because of what the person who believes does or is, then, in a sense, he is responsible for his salvation and has a reason to boast, because that would be his own efforts. However, if the difference is solely that Yahweh does something unique in the hearts and lives of those who believe in him and are saved, then there is no ground for boasting, for any individual, for any Christian boasting. And there is no ground that salvation is, and there is no grant, and there is grant instead. That salvation is truly a gift of grace, not a kind of reward because of our own efforts. Of course, the scriptural answer to these questions is that the Holy Spirit does do something unique in the hearts of those who are saved. Scripture tells us that Yahweh saves people, I quote, Yahweh saves people, I quote, according to his mercy, through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit, end of quote. This is in Titus 3 verse 5. In other words, those who believe the gospel and are saved do so because they have been transformed by the Holy Spirit. Scripture describes natural man as, I quote, dead in his trespasses and sins, end of quote. The natural man in Scripture is described as the one dead in his trespasses and sins, end of quote. This is said in Ephesians 2 verse 1 and verse 5 and Colossians 2 verse 3. And the scripture says this is because man is spiritually dead. So man, the natural man that we are talking about, not the regenerated man, the natural man must first be made alive, or another word for alive is regenerated, spiritually regenerated, in order to understand and respond to the gospel message. A good illustration of this is seen in Yahshua raising Lazarus from the dead. In John 11, verse 43, Yahshua told Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus came forth out of the tomb. What had to happen to Lazarus? What had to happen before Lazarus, who had been dead for several days, four in total, which means even the body was decomposing, was getting rotten. What had to happen before Lazarus would be able to respond to Yahshua's command? He had to be made alive. Lazarus had to be made alive, because a dead man cannot hear and even less respond. The same is true then spiritually with a natural man that is regenerated. If he is dead in our sins, then before he can respond to the gospel message and believe on the Lord Yahshua Christ, he must first be made alive. He must first be resurrected. As Yahshua told Nicodemus, the Pharisean Nicodemus, the believing Pharisean Nicodemus in John 3 verse 3, one must be, I quote Yahshua, born again. Born again, one must be born again to see. One must be born again to see. One must be born again to see. To see the light of God. One must be born again to see the light of God. And Lazarus and Nicodemus was asking himself, how can a man be born again? Then just Yahshua explained to him that this is spiritually, this is not physical man. You are reasoning as a natural man. In John 1 verses 12 to 13 tells us that being born again is not the result of something we do. The will of man, between quote, this is not the will of man. But this is a sovereign act of God. Just as Lazarus could not bring himself back to life or respond to Yahweh's command without being brought back to life, neither can sinful man be brought to faith and salvation. Ephesians 2 verses 1 to 10 makes it very clear that while we are dead in our trespasses and sin, Yahweh makes us alive. Then, therefore, being born again or being regenerated is a sovereign act of God. One of these acts that he called, that the angel says, with God, nothing is impossible. Yahweh makes us alive. It is something Yahweh does which enables us to believe the gospel message. Not something that comes as a result of our own efforts or works to believe. This grace is therefore called irreversible, because it always results in the intended outcome, which is the salvation of the person, that the salvation of the person it is given to. It is important to realize that the act of being regenerated or born again cannot be separated from the act of believing the gospel. There is a connection between the act of being made alive by God, as it is said in Ephesians 2 verses 1 and 5, and the result of being saved by grace, as it is said in Ephesians 2 verses 5 and 8. This is because everything pertaining to salvation, including faith, including the faith to believe, is an act of Yahweh's grace. The reason Yahweh's grace is irreversible and efficacious, that means always bringing forth the desired result, is that Yahweh, I quote, has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into his kingdom. End of quote. This is quoting Colossians 1 verse 13. Or as Psalm 3 verse 8 puts it, salvation, I quote, salvation belongs to Yahweh. End of quote. So to understand the doctrine of irreversible grace, we must recognize that this is special.